Come to order, please.
Sometimes you have epiphanies when you're eating food, but tell me why, I mean, just, this is just a matter of law issue right now, but why should the confidentiality, assuming there is something that is labeled and held to be confidential, why should it apply at this stage of the game when we're talking about just matter of law issues and not matters of fact later on down the road? I just thought that seemingly to me right now, while we're just going through these jurisdictional issues, maybe it really doesn't matter.
If I understand the court's inquiry, the protections that are afforded to a confidential document do not turn on whether or not the use in the case is going to be for purposes of legal analysis or for factual development. The confidentiality would apply because of what could be done with that information in improper hands, for example. That's the immediate example that comes to mind. You don't...
Well, I agree. My point is it keeps it out of the public's eyes.
Or use in... Your Honor, what...
And it keeps Goodyear from having to come up with a new tire formula.
Exactly. Or to use it competitively to their advantage somewhere else.
Well, if there was a protective order post litigation, anybody who did have access to whatever information during litigation, wouldn't that at least be a layer of protection? And obviously, it would subject somebody to the very least contempt of court if they violated.
Can't disagree or argue with that as far as it goes, Your Honor. But what is going on here, this is one skirmish in a battle that has many, many fronts. If the court can get an appreciation of how this could be used and is being used in litigation that Mr. Rathbun is instigating, participating in, instrumental in, jurisdictions across this country, and quite frankly, Your Honor, across the world. He is involved in his attempts in places beyond the borders of this country. The confidentiality...
Your Honor, I need to object. I'm sorry. They keep saying this. He has been called as a witness in some cases, and I just can't sit here and let them go on and on about how he's instigating litigation anywhere.
I'm answering the court's question, Your Honor, and I appreciate doing it without interruptions. That's all he's doing, is interrupting. There's no jury here you're playing to. You might be playing to the movie cameras. I'm trying to answer your question. The confidentiality protections, Your Honor, are global. It's a thou shalt not, and that covers us for things that we can't even imagine or conceive that might be on his agenda. Your order would have to be respected, and then we got the waterfront covered. I don't know what all he's going to do with it. I don't have to know if I have the protection and the order justified here. It has that effect. That's why the distinction the court is making, that, you know, well, maybe at the stage when we're dealing with issues of law, it may not be as important as if we get into the fact, you know, application and so forth. That's why that distinction, although it may apply in many, many cases, I don't think quite fits our situation, is the answer I would give.
I think, again, we get into just the balancing.
And Judge, on the balancing part, you know,
a lot of issues. I mean, because I'm one, and I'm sure everybody in this room is just as, or at least as, maybe differing. Obviously, everybody's different, so to different degrees. But I'm very much a proponent of the sanctity of marriage, husband and wife, and that it issue that cannot be otherwise insulated by way of a protective order. That's in this situation. I hate to invade that sanctity.
And I got two answers for that, Sean. And I had this epiphany when I was having my sandwich, believe it or not. We are not seeking any blocking of communication that would take place in any case that would be in front of you where the spouse wasn't possessed of this specialized knowledge acquired in the way Mr. Rathbun had it. In other words, if this was a case where he had no connection, as he does here, there would be no mention. I would agree to the spouse being added, but that's fine. That spouse in that situation, Your Honor, would be engaged in all the sanctity type communications that a normal husband and wife would have. They would be there to see each other through it, hold their hands, talk it through, give comfort, all the things that you want to foster. And we're not attempting to prevent him from doing any of that. The best way I thought of it actually over lunch was, if you segregate away what he has done, and how he has done it, and where he has been, and why they want him to be an expert, and a specialized knowledge expert, and counsel is very forthcoming with him. He said, if he has specialized knowledge, that's an expert. You know, we need to consult with him. That's a consultant. If the husband was not in a position to provide those two, he would be in a relationship with the wife where they could give each other all the comfort and talk and do everything, and nobody up here would be saying boo. But this is the situation that they're creating, and Judge, I mean, quite frankly, he's manufacturing. You know, one of the things that is very ironic, you know, counsel wants to tell you what our litigious history and our scorched earth and so forth. Your Honor, he has admitted that whatever reputation we have as a church for being litigious, he orchestrated it and created it and was the moving force behind it. And then he gets to tell Wikipedia what we are, because that's what we were when he was running everything. We have had remarkable peace since he exited. The only wars we have are the ones he keeps bringing up. We were able to settle things that have been raging for 20 years with the IRS. We were able to settle all kinds of litigation we've been involved in.
Yeah, that's argumentation, Your Honor.
My point is, I'm trying to answer your question, Your Honor. That is who the spouse is in this case. And had, if he wasn't that, then, you know, it'd be the normal case where the spouse can give whatever comfort they want.
Mr. Ray, don't we open the door for future attack on my ruling regarding the disqualification issue to the extent that it is true that all of a sudden potential confidential information might be used to consult with, to whatever degree, quote, unquote, with Mr. Rathbun over his prior knowledge along with whatever is confidential?
No, Your Honor. No. In fact, we're dying to do battle with them on whatever this supposed confidential information is. The only reason why we're in this somewhat nebulous area is they keep trying to push you into the analysis of what happens where an attorney or a non-attorney employee of a party or a law firm changes side in the same matter, in the same, etc. The point I want to make to you is, if you look, for example, at Mr. Rathbun's affidavit that he gave, the affidavit is about just practices and procedures and how things work in that organization. That's not confidential under any sense of protection that we have for protective orders, etc. And I'll point out to the court, and we'll bring them, Mr. Miscavige and Mr. Cartwright, who's sitting over there, and Warren McShane, one of their other corporate representatives, they have given affidavits and sworn declarations 30, 40 pages long, going into every detail of how things work from their perspective. All we have done is given one affidavit that contradicts what their party line is about how things work. Where is this confidential stuff? That's what I don't understand. And they still, as many times as I ask them, they still don't identify what the confidential stuff is. Instead, they want to say...
Well, we're just not to that point yet.
Correct.
And Your Honor, here's the argument you just heard. He says there are 10 things that are confidential. Let's say that we could identify a universe, and I'll just use 10 things. And he says... 6 of those things have already been discussed in affidavits, or they're here, they're there. Tell me what the other 4 are.
Excuse me, sir.
I don't interrupt him, Your Honor. I appreciate it. He didn't interrupt me. His argument is, tell me what the other 4 are that we don't know about, so we can fight about whether or not they're confidential. Judge, it really doesn't matter that we don't have a situation where a paralegal left, you know, went from point A to point B. If you look at it under the analogy I'm suggesting to you, Your Honor, the reason it's an irrebuttable presumption is because to make it something other than irrebuttable, I would have to disclose the other 4 things in order for you to decide, and the cat's out of the bag at that point. That's why it's irrebuttable. If it falls within it, and I understand the court's concern that the cases are not, you know, white horse cases dead on, this is a very unusual situation. But the public policy and the logic in all those cases that Mr. Spencer argued before you covers the situation that I'm talking about. We are not required to tell him what the other 4 things are in my example before you rule whether or not we were right. If he fits in the specialized knowledge category, and he does, by counsel's own argument and admission, and they want to use him as a consultant, they want him to fit the Western Conference order in the first part. But they don't want to name him that way because they think they can get it in the second part by adding the spouse. And that is something the Western District order doesn't contemplate. It's not part of it. And it's not unusual, Your Honor, because I think really what's going on, it's presumed that you're going to go home, you're going to talk to your wife to whatever extent you need to or want to or have to. But you're not, it's not contemplated, you're going to do it, and your wife happens to be able to say, I can now use this as your consultant or as your expert witness because of these circumstances and be able to assist you. And not be under the consultant or the expert witness coverage in the protective order. I mean, they want to put us in a catch-22 by creating something the Western District Forum does not contemplate. And they want us, their argument is, give it all up and then we'll tell you whether you can respect it or not. And under the facts and circumstances that have us here, Your Honor, that's not fair.
Well, I mean, the thought process about the difference between a matter of law that's just kind of being decided here amongst us chickens. I would just like to think, whether it's a limited matter of law issue or matter of fact, that I would certainly time being for the purposes of this jurisdictional fight, family law fight. I don't mind adding the word spouse to that, but I think once we get beyond this, I probably remove it. So we all going to have to manage that. Because in my mind, the idea of confidentiality is to limit the world's access to that information. So while we're just dealing with issues that are here close to the vest, within fewer folks, that's my point, is I don't think it's that big of an issue to not allow spouse. That in any way, that ruling in any way affect the other motion, Mr. Petcher?
Well, I think we need to have a hearing on the second motion. It's not just possible.
Okay. I'm just kidding.
May I proceed?
Yes.
And Your Honor, I noticed, having been in this courtroom many times, I was used to being seated because the microphones were at a level that was appropriate to being seated, and I noticed I was the only person one standing up, and I certainly was not intending any disrespect. May I use my usual custom? And
you may, absolutely. One time many years ago, I was in Judge Suttle's courtroom and as an intern, and he, I had to give my coat up to a DEA agent who ran in the courtroom, and they were making sure I had special dispensation to remain in the courtroom. Judge Suttle, like, way too long, it's like, don't waste your time. Let the boy sit down. I feel the same. I'm not that particular.
Your Honor, do you still have the bound booklet that I left on hand?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir, because I'm going to refer to a couple of things in there as I go. Your Honor, the second motion is our motion of limiting the protective order, which is language that we took from the concluding paragraph of your order denying the disqualification. And I, since you wrote it, you probably don't need to remind me of it very much, but you did say, and it's under tab, your order is under tab one, on the last page 8, you said, short of disqualification, one could look to lesser measures to limit and or prevent any further disclosure of the alleged confidential information. And of course, your point in saying that was that disqualification is such a severe and harsh remedy, and that recognized by the Supreme Court and many others. But what this motion this afternoon addresses is my attempt, our attempt, to request a framework of lesser measures, restrictions on plaintiff's counsel, and through them on Mr. Rathbun, that will, in words of your order, limit and or prevent any further disclosure of my client's confidential information. And because the law on this is not necessarily intuitive, with your permission, I would like to go back through a couple of these cases and briefly point out why Mr. Jeffrey's arguments about the scope of confidential information, which is the language the Supreme Court can use, and some of the other things he has said with respect to what the law is, are, in my opinion, incorrect. But before we get to the cases, I'd like you, if you could, to turn to tab 4, which is a copy of Mr. Rathbun's affidavit. This the court will recall, is an affidavit that was attached in September, and yes, Mr. Fuccio told the court in an earlier hearing, they were mindful of the 7-day rule that evidence that's going to come in on a special appearance has to be, if it's an affidavit form, has to be filed at least 7 days before the hearing. And the way that first special appearance hearing got scheduled, they were really under the gun and scrambling to get something put together. And I actually did not realize that time constraint. I hadn't thought of it in my head. And I want to say about that, I think your order has been helpful to me as well. Personally, some of the language that was used earlier, such as unethical or immoral, versus matter of fact, was in Hamburg and not justified. It's very appropriate for this court to control the any further dispersion of confidential information of my client, but I think it may get carried away sometimes in the moment. But if you would turn to that affidavit, and what I'd like you to look at is paragraphs 25 and 26, is tab 4 of the binder I handed up, and paragraph 25, and I've highlighted the first line there. If, and this is Mr. Rathbun's description of lawsuits, if a lawsuit named or sought discovery that involved Mr. Miscavige, I oversaw every aspect of that litigation until Mr. Miscavige was no longer subject to inquiry. And then he continues in this paragraph 26, which we've also highlighted, the thing that has come up so many times, and just the importance of which cannot be overemphasized. Mr. Rathbun says, for more than 20 years, the Office of Special Affairs, OSA, of the Church of Scientology International answered to me. And I just remind the court that Church, defendant, Church of Scientology International, is Mr. Steele, my client. Continuing, under the close supervision of Mr. Miscavige, I directed OSA's extensive various things, including criminal and civil legal matters. Mr. Rathbun was the director of legal affairs for two decades of our company. And if you look now at to go to how the Supreme Court of Texas has repeatedly characterized what occurs when somebody in that type of a position, or even much lesser positions, switches sides, it is very clear that restrictions are needed. If the court could look, let's look first at the In Re American Homes case, which is under tab 7. I'd like the court to look at page 4. And the first, on the left-hand side of that page, the part that's highlighted there, the Supreme Court points out that there was an argument in that case about what to call Ms. Velasquez. Was she a freelance consultant? Was she a paralegal? Maybe something else. And they said the title is not important. What's important is that, as they say in the last sentence of that highlighted paragraph, the tasks she performed were the same as those that might be executed by a legal assistant as a full-time employee of a law firm or by a legal assistant in the legal department of a party. And here, so the job title isn't important, but what I would want to emphasize to the court is Mr. Rathbun, as expressed in his affidavit, was doing legal work and legal tasks that are so far in excess of what a legal assistant would do that it can scarcely be put into words. So that being true, that Mr. Despite being a non-attorney, not holding a state law license, Mr. Rathbun was the director of legal affairs. And that being true, if you look over to the opposite column on that same page 4, the Supreme Court says that they had squarely held in the earlier case of Phoenix Founders that when a paralegal or legal assistant who has worked on a case must be subject to a conclusive presumption that confidences and secrets were imparted. And this is what Mr. Cedillo was referring to in his argument a moment ago. They continue. The need for that conclusive presumption is exhibited in this case. It serves to prevent the moving party from being forced to reveal the very confidences sought to be protected. And that, of course, is, again, what Mr. Scandillo was emphasizing in his argument speech. And directly contrary to Mr. Jeffrey's continuing challenge to us, that Mr. Scandillo and I have to identify what the confidences are, how many there are, what categories they have, all of that is an argument that was urged by the losing party in the American Home Products case, rejected by the Supreme Court. We need to do none of that. There's a conclusive presumption that people, even functioning at much lesser levels of involvement in legal affairs than Mr. Rathbun.
It's all the North Plant litigation, right?
Yeah.
Or on this case when they're citing Phoenix.
That's correct.
And that's not what we're dealing with. And that's
I understand that tension, and I have absolutely promised the court I'm going to come to that in just a moment, because you talked about the substantial relationship component of this that we need to show you why it is that what Mr. Rathbun worked on in 20 years has something to do with this case, and I absolutely understand that, and I promise the court I will come to it. But before we leave this page of the American Home Products, I do want to just continue with the Supreme Court's holdings, which really are important in directly rebutting and refuting what Mr. Jeffrey has been arguing continuously, because they say that and again, this is in that on the right-hand column on that page, the risk that occurred, this is the final sentence the risk that a person who has functioned as a legal assistant may disclose confidential information from your employer under circumstances such as these is unacceptably high. And needless to say, our client says amen to that. It is unacceptable to us that Mr. Rathbun may divulge in our conferences to a party who's suing us and trying to get cheat out with a lot of money. But then this issue of what it is that he should be precluded from passing on is the Supreme Court adopts the term confidential information. And this is at the bottom of page 4, that they adopt as the universe of information, confidential information, which is a defined term. It's much more, and I hope, because again, Mr. Jeffrey was talking about it, I pulled out my, bar book, and it's rule 1.05A, and it's a defined term, quote, confidential information, close quote, includes both, quote, privileged information, close quote, and, quote, unprivileged client information. And privileged information is what you think it is. It's attorney-client privilege, drug product, stuff like that. And to their, and I want to give, credit for credit's due. Mr. Jeffrey has told us in a letter that they will not try to get confidential information from Mr. Rathbun, and we respect that.
Attorney-client privilege.
What did I say? Privilege?
Confidential.
Then I misspoke, because I apologize. Thank you for correcting.
Take back the credit.
I'm so uncomfortable with it, Your Honor. I just assume he did.
He is correct. But they have offered to set up whatever barriers and restrictions they can, such that Mr. Rathbun does not pass on privileged information. Thank you for that. But he also, the rule encompasses unprivileged client information, which is a defined term. I just want to read the definition. Unprivileged client information means all information related to a client or furnished by the client other than privileged information acquired by the lawyer during the course of or by reason of the representation of the client. Just about as broad as conceivable. It's everything you learn in the course of representing someone, either as an attorney, which is the way the rule is wording, but as applied by the Supreme Court, if you're involvement has been as a paralegal, a consultant, a legal director, everything you learn during the course of that is confidential. Well, it's the subset, unprivileged client information, which is a part of confidential information. That is a very, very broad universe of information. Now we come to the question the court raised, which is, that what is it about what Mr. Rathbun learned in his 20 years as legal director that is substantially related to what's in controversy in this case? Well, you'll recall that in his affidavit, he talks about the fact that any time Mr. Miscavige is sued, he, Mr. Rathbun, was absolutely involved in the details of it and everything that needed to be done to get Mr. Miscavige. What is the case in front of you? it is that very type of case. The claim, and I'm certainly not going to read it because it would take way too long, but the plaintiff's pleading and Mr. Rathbun's affidavit in its entirety can be summarized in the concept that Mr. Miscavige and RTC, Mr. Jefferson's clients, are in total control of my client, that they do everything, of, and then hide. And they're hiding in all kinds of ways that are supposed to be detailed by Mr. Rathbun in his affidavit. That's exactly what is in controversy in this case. That's what they play. And that's what Mr. Rathbun says in his affidavit, the type of information that he has. He knows he has confidential information that he acquired as legal director about the practices, about the procedures, about the strategies that are supposedly employed. And again, as Mr. Cedillo, I should let him talk. He's done such a great job. But as he was pointing out to you just moments ago, Mr. Jeffrey has repeatedly argued, both this morning and this afternoon, that Mr. Rathbun is an expert on these things, that he's going to be consulting with them on these things. That what things? How do they keep Mr. Miscavige out of lawsuits? How do they, dissemble and hide stuff and do things? That's exactly what they have pled in this case, and that's exactly what Mr. Rathbun in his affidavit says he knows about. One other thing that may occur in court or would raise it even hasn't is Mr. Rathbun in his affidavit says that he left the church in 2004. So what's that? 9 years ago, possibly. That the passage of time by itself does not prevent this rule of forbidding lawyers for a party from getting confidential information from someone such as Mr. Rathbun. And just as by way of example, to find a case where it was even farther in the past that the person had worked for the other side, we've attached the Bell helicopter case, which is under tab 10. You don't need to, unless you wish to, I'll just represent to you that in that case, the person had worked, it'd been 14 years had passed between the time that the person had worked on the Bell helicopter side and the time that it had come up in court. That's on page 4 of the Bell helicopter's case. Unless you just wish to confirm that, I don't think you need to confirm that.
What type of substantial involvement?
She had been working on that product liability, those type of cases. As I say, the mere passage of time does not.
Not the same product. Being litigated again with a different plaintiff or something.
I would have to reread the case to be able to accurately answer the court.
It's product liability defense for the connection.
Could you hear what you said?
Right.
Product liability defense work. I haven't read it in a while, but that's the appropriate case.
Was it like this? Same product, in other words,
The same components.
Components that keep coming up as product liability factors in litigation.
And now I turn to it's the very first page for that. The safety systems, crash resistant fuel systems. Thank you for detailing
this.
Different lawsuits.
But all what they had in common, Your Honor, were product liability contentions by component parts.
Thank you very much. And that's the same thing here. Different lawsuits, but the same contention. Mr. Miscavige runs everything. RTC, I can't even remember how they claim it all happens, but the idea is that the defendants, the parties represented by counsel at this table here, those defendants are one single bad bunch of guys run by Mr. Miscavige, and that any corporate forms are illusions. And I don't know what words they use, but you get the idea. That's the same thing that in his affidavit he describes how he was working on accomplishing.
Send up a hypothetical?
Of course.
Mr. Jeffries and all these guys out of the law firm. New counsel coming. Or,
Yeah.
Mr. Rathbun. Jefferson right where he is in a future date. And all of a sudden, here's something that he believes he possesses certain knowledge, but he would be forbidden to convey that to whoever counsel was sitting there at the table. But if you counter that, what we just heard with this. And my ultimate point there is, again, that if we can invade the sanctity of marriage and prevent that from happening, we can almost invade parent-child relationship, which is almost anything. And that is really...
Well, but isn't that the point of all of these disqualification tests? Is that if you don't stop that, if you don't stop, in most cases, the paralegal, in this case, the director of legal affairs, if you don't stop them from doing that, the confidences will be betrayed. And this is, and I think you recognize this in your order, and the cases do themselves, there is a balancing here of competing public policies.
Well, like there was one case where it was, there was some discussion about it. And I think I saw it.
I think perhaps the N. Ray Netter case, is that one you're remembering, Judge? No. They did talk about it a lot. The NIPA?
No, it was where I mentioned in my order that there's a balance of social concerns to be had.
I remember that language as well, and I'm not immediately... page five. Starts the paragraph, starting framing the issue in its broadest context.
Probably so, yeah. Maybe it was in either the Columbia, and then I've done my own, that Reen case.
The Columbia case is attached under tab,
In lawyer tab versus eight. Non-lawyer employees.
Right. But there is no question that by saying that someone who has confidential information, that this broad universe of information, may not use it. Sure, yeah, that pinches. That's what, if it didn't, we wouldn't be having this argument.
Well, in all those, like in the Bell helicopter case, that again, it's getting down to five.
But Your Honor, I'm sorry, my habit always get on. But Your Honor, this is the part of the public policy that I think isn't being focused on. The reason that you have the confidential mandate in a situation like this, anyone can say, look, I was there for X number of years, and this is how they did it. And he lists, again, 10 things that are wrong. They're secret, they're hiding, they're doing something, you know, immoral or corrupt. That's the allegations against us. Okay. The reason you say to someone who says, I was there, I'm in a position to tell you that I know that they do these five things that are morally despicable. The reason you shut that down, Your Honor, isn't because you want to hide what's morally despicable. It's because the public policy is that kind of person shouldn't be in a position to make that allegation, which will be believed, because it seems to have the indication of reliability, because after all, he says I was there. When the only way I can refute it, Your Honor, is to say, no, this is how we do it. Work product that invades attorney-client communication, that invades proprietary information, confidentiality. The harm or the policy behind shutting it down at the bud is because it is impractical and unworkable. If you're going to respect the rights of the parties, you can't do that. You cannot respect my rights when you say under guise of, well, the sanctity of marriage, or
the other side of the coin is to take my position further. That would say in a hypothetical situation would write a blank check, so to speak, to a former employee's company to do do whatever you want to do to my family. We can't come back.
Well, Your Honor, I think that's taking it much
maybe beyond, to the absurd.
Well, to way beyond what we're talking about here. What we're talking about here is, here's what the Supreme Court has said. If you fit this category of person, there are reasons why it's a conclusive presumption, irrevocable presumption. Part of that reason, Your Honor, is because it's unfair to the party that is going to resist it to come forth and negate it by showing what the secrets really are, especially when the allegation is being made that you're doing illegal things to accomplish it. And we're saying, no, we're not. We're doing these legal things. That's the only way you can get the question before a fact finder. And what the rules say, no, but in the first instance, when the guy says, I know they were doing these illegal things because I was there and I directed that and I worked with lawyers and I told them what to do. I was the head of legal affairs and I did A, B, and C. You know, we say, no, you didn't do that. We didn't do that. We can say everything we want, but we're not going to win that argument in this court or in the court of public opinion. They want to be able to do it for a lot of different reasons without disclosing our actual work product or our mental impressions or our trade secrets or whatever it is if you're dealing over here. That's the rationale of the law, Your Honor.
I understand and appreciate that. One of the things that I've conditioned with a lot of different dichotomies we're dealing with is, and I go back to it again, it's probably part of the reason have the thought over lunch about the difference between matter of law and matter of fact. Most of these cases that we all looked at before are all going to the NFL Hill Conference. It's the issues of fact that are going to be decided. Maybe the Norplant litigation as well. Issues of fact have to be decided by the jury or something else that can't switch sides midstream and don't reveal. Are any of these cases limited to issues of law that the judge is going to decide?
Well, I think...
like jurisdiction?
Jurisdiction is an issue of law, but it is determined based on the facts that have been presented to you. And Judge, we do not have a jury in the box. All of us know that. But this courtroom is open to people. There's, I don't know if it's running right now, but there's a movie camera right over there.
We're not revealing any such...
No, but if your idea is that as long as we're just in this jurisdictional phase maybe give them more rope and or have a looser leash than you will later on. This there's a lot of information is going to be coming out that is they're going to be trying very hard to get this confidential information before you. And even if you're the only fact finder on this. And it's going to be just as harmful and just as detrimental to our client if that happens in this courtroom where it's a non-jury hearing as it would be if there were 12 citizens sitting next to us.
Your Honor, just to conclude so you can hear everything that we're saying, I don't mean to interrupt. It just occurred to me, Judge, the fact law is a distinction without a difference. The Norplant cases, yeah, they dealt with specific facts. Tending to prove liability, let's say, okay? If that paralegal had knowledge about, jurisdiction fights or statute of limitations fights or anything that's decided by applying facts to the law, the prohibition would apply to that paralegal just as well. As long as questions of law are factually determined, and so I don't think it makes any difference, Your Honor.
They're different degrees.
But to this degree, if there was a paralegal who was in charge of, creating, let's say, scenarios so that a statute of limitations defense would work. Let's say a person calls in and complains about a product. And their job is to, prolong and stretch it out and get them beyond statute of limitations, then that's a fact-driven application of a legal, something that's legally determined with statute of limitations. Those fact situations If the paralegal were to come up and say, yeah, I was instructed to prolong this thing so that they'd have statute of limitations problems. Okay, our answer, or the defense answer would be, that's not true. That isn't a directive. We didn't do it that way. Okay, then how did you do it? I mean, I'm left with, I actually saw this in an argument once. I did an argument, and the only thing the other guy could say was, uh-uh. that was it. That's all we'd be saying is, uh-uh. Paralegal said, I was there, and I was directed to do this, 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 and this, so that these people would have statute of limitations problem. Question of law. What am I supposed to say in defense to that? Uh-uh. That's all I'd be doing if I said, no, we didn't. I'd have to come forth with what our policies and procedures were internally. I'd have to come forth with things that nobody's business. And the rule would apply to tell that person that. Now, you were there, and you want to say X, Y, and Z because you were there. The rule applies and says, no, you don't.
And I don't know, under your hypothetical, you're thinking, could certain prophylactic measures be taken, such as closing the courtroom, limiting or eliminating the media? We've got to fight those battles too, I'm sure. But there's got to be lesser or alternate measures, in my view.
The Supreme Court,
in debating a certain relationship to me or the highest level.
I'm not suggesting you invade it, Your Honor. I suggest you allow it. Allow it to the level that it would exist in any situation where the spouse wasn't trying to be backdoored in as an expert or someone there. They can have all the spousal communication that anybody else would have, absent this situation. What makes this different is the application of the confidentiality rule. And I understand the court's search for lesser measures. The Supreme Court has not given us lesser measures in a situation like this, Your Honor.
And Judge, I know Mr. Jeffries is very eager to reply, and I asked him if he would just let me, I'm very close to the end of my presentation, and appreciate his forbearance on that. Judge, the last case I want you to look at is a new one. It's a new book that I didn't cite earlier, and also it was quite new in terms of when I cited it. It's under tab 9. It's the Henry Aaron Insurance case, Supreme Court of Texas decision in 2011. And if you would look on page 4, this is a case in which the Supreme Court recognized that a paralegal who can change sides created a problem, and that problem needed to be addressed. And the issue was, had the Strasburger law firm adequately instituted protections and formal institutional measures to make sure this paralegal didn't divulge any confidential information? And the Supreme Court concluded that the types of measures that the Strasburger firm had employed were sufficient and reversed the disqualification. So the point of this case for you is, what type of measures does the Supreme Court say you need to take to make sure that confidential information is not, doesn't go where it shouldn't go? And you'll see there that the top of the right-hand column where they're talking about the way to rebut the presumption that they have been passed is to instruct the legal assistant not to work on this, not to do things. And then the second thing is to take other reasonable steps. And if you turn over to the top of page 5, they talk about that the non-lawyer should be cautioned, not to do things. And it is that language, instruct, caution, those are the things that I have translated into the 6 really very simple requests that are in my motion, and that's, of course, the very top of the book. And what we are asking you to do is to require the plaintiff and her counsel, number one, not to seek confidential information. And again, we're using that term because that's the one the Supreme Court has repeatedly used. Don't try to get it from them. Number two, is perhaps saying the same thing in different words, not to attempt to elicit confidential information regarding the defendants from Mr. Rathbun while he's testifying. In other words, tell these lawyers, don't be careful, be certain that when you're questioning him, that you don't frame your questions in a way that would cause him to reveal his confidential information. Then we ask that the plaintiff's counsel instruct Mr. Rathbun as to what confidential information means, so he won't have any questions about what we're talking about here, and instruct him not to volunteer it, either while testifying or in other contexts. And then we're asking that you forbid them from using him as an expert, consultant, or an advisor in this case, because if they do that, they're going to get, then they're going to have to be back and forth seeking disqualification. They'll be in a situation where they're within those cases. The last two are that they not use confidential information, if any, already. Well, there's certainly the stuff in the affidavits that's already out there, but if there's anything that they have gotten inadvertently or otherwise that would constitute confidential information from Mr. Rathbun, that they not use it in this case. And then lastly, that they, not the public, not anybody else, but that the plaintiff and her counsel not further disseminate the affidavit. I think those are very straightforward, simple types of cautions and instructions that are the types of things the Supreme Court commended the Strasburg Report for doing, and that they are the lesser measures that are appropriate here in this case. And they're appropriate from day one. They're appropriate now because there are going to be depositions taken. Said repeatedly, the defendants have agreed to certain depositions, and I think we've even got dates for them now. As soon as the protective order is entered, there are going to be documents supplied to them. We really need these kinds of common sense restrictions on Mr. Rathbun, the director of legal affairs, a man who says he knows he was intimately involved in exactly these types of cases. We need to restrict that, and that's what the Supreme Court is doing. Thank you for your patience.
Mayor, when the smoke clears, I think it's critical that we identify and acknowledge that there are three categories of former employees of some parties, or employees or agents, that make a difference in how you analyze these issues. One issue is, what if you have a lawyer who worked for these corporations, and then that lawyer leaves and wants to go talking about what he knows from working for those corporations. Their request, which Mr. Spencer makes sound so reasonable and moderate, is to use that idea of confidential information, which is in the rules of professional conduct for lawyers, 1.05A. And if you come to me and I represent you as a lawyer under 1.05A, I can't reveal any of our attorney-client communications, and furthermore, I can't reveal anything that I ever learn about you from any source in connection with that representation. That's the broad, and that's what we agree to as lawyers. The second category of person who has worked with a corporation and then goes over and wants to in some way be involved in some litigation against that corporation is a lawyer or non-lawyer who worked on the matter, on that type of litigation. And you could never get a really clear answer to this question from the Bell Helicopters case. In the conclusion, the court says very clearly, the record shows that while Vail worked for Bell, she obtained confidential information about the Model 412 aircraft and its fuel safety system as well as confidential information about Bell's litigation strategies and attorney work product in lawsuits involving the Model 412 aircraft. Okay? That's what all these cases are. And it, when you have that type of situation, then they don't define it exactly as 1.05, but it is a broader category. The courts just say, hey, when you're jumping sides in that litigation or in that matter or in that, whether it's the particular case or a chain of cases on that matter, we're just going to presume that you've got, you know, harmful information, confidential, we're just going to presume that. Mr. Rathbun falls in the third category of person, which is, and this would apply to almost any high-level person at any corporation, and that is, he worked at the corporation, he worked at the top levels, he worked with the top people, he was also involved with legal matters. That's in his affidavit. We don't contest that. But the question is, number one, he's not changing sides. He didn't work on a bunch of cases of harassing some lady who was out there in South Texas, you know, the same type of litigation. So he doesn't fall into those categories. So the question becomes, and this is why I keep asking, what is the confidential information? And we've never asked for any item of confidential information. We just want to know categories. What is the kinds of stuff, like in other cases, customer lists and that sort of thing? And so I want to just get, you know, the judge has approached a lot of these things with hypotheticals. What if, and remember, all of this comes up in responding to their affirmative motion to get a dismissal on jurisdiction grounds. And Mr. Miscavige and Warren McShane at RTC have submitted these affidavits saying, hey, we don't have anything to do with Texas, we're not involved in any of this stuff. And in response to that, we produce this evidence. And I want to give you a hypothetical. What would happen if in response to this, Mr. Rathbun said, wait a second, I flew once a month with David Miscavige to Texas to collect donations from Scientologists in Texas for 20 years. Now, because he has worked on some legal matters, that matter which is not confidential, which is not a matter of legal strategy in some case, he cannot rebut a lie in a declaration or affidavit that's been submitted to the court that he has personal knowledge of. That is not the case, and they have not shown you one case that a person with knowledge, even a high-level person, cannot talk about anything when he's in litigation in an unrelated matter. That's what I think is critical here. If you look at what he is saying in his affidavit, he's saying, wait a second, okay, I've seen this special appearance and these declarations filed, in which they say, we don't have anything to do with Texas. And he said, yes, this is how it works. This type of matter, he micromanages. He's not revealing some confidence from this case. He's just telling you what the procedures and practices of the corporations and the top level people at the corporations are. That is not appropriate. Now, they have phrased this, and we haven't even addressed it. A motion in limine is a motion made to, it's not a motion in limine. In effect, what it is, it is an injunction.
Served as a protective measure to prevent offensive use rather than defensive use of certain information.
But it's a what type of a protective measure? It is, in essence, an injunction. They're asking the court to issue an injunction, an order. And an injunction is just an order requiring certain behavior or prohibiting certain behavior. and they're asking the court to issue an injunction saying what Mr. Rathbun and I can talk about, or what Mr. Rathbun and his wife can talk about. And that is not a motion in limine. That is a gag order instructing people what they can talk about with whom. That is presumptively unconstitutional, and they haven't even made an attempt to show why that would not be unconstitutional. Again, with this category of human being, not an attorney, not a non-attorney employee who has switched sides in the same matter. Instead, a high-level executive from an organization. By the way, I don't think he ever had the title Director of Legal Affairs. That was never his title. They keep saying that. High-level employee who left the company 10 years ago or whatever it is, and who has knowledges about the practices and procedures. Okay, they just went through down in Florida in federal court down there 2 or 3 weeks ago a hearing to disqualify the attorneys down there in that case. And they complained about Mr. Rathbun, they complained about Mr. Render, they complained about an attorney who had actually used to work for the Church of Scientology that was working on the other side. And the court kept asking them again and again, where's the confidential information? What is the confidential information? And just like here, they never can identify it. And that motion was denied on the spot that day. So what they are, in essence, asking, if you step back and take the 30,000-foot view, they're saying, let us put anything we want into the record, the affidavits and declarations from anyone that we have currently within our organization, saying that we don't have anything to do with Texas. But you cannot find anyone who used to be with the organization to say that's simply not true.
Well, and that's why I mentioned the different distinction between offensive and defensive. But I don't know what.
Your Honor, they could ask the pilot. They could ask the people they supposedly came and fundraised with. They could, to say that you know, they're powerless, practically, no, that's just facially absurd. Secondly, are you aware, Your Honor, that every time you issue orders in limine and every case that you are involved in, you have unconstitutionally done a prior restraint and issued gag orders? Because that's what is being argued, is what a motion limiting request or order on your part would be. And that's absolutely ludicrous. And I think the court, in the last paragraph of your order, you reasonably did the motion limiting, so we took guidance by your analysis and your logic. And you said the aggrieved party could seek a ruling on a motion in limine and or object to the admission of confidential information. I grant you, most limine requests that you see are on the trial as part of the final pretrial conference, but there's nothing that limits us to doing them there. And when we kind of, you know, look at the hard work you put into crafting this order, and we seek guidance from it, we say, okay, within the framework of what the court is trying to do here, how can we achieve the lesser measures and so forth? So we came forth before you with a motion of limine, not because we're seeking injunctions, not because we want gag orders, not because we want you to unconstitutionally issue prior restraints or free speech, because that's not what a motion of limine is, and to suggest otherwise just doesn't border on the absurd. It is absurd.
Your Honor, in a motion in limine, normally what happens is the party asks on the eve of trial, the party asks the judge, would you just rule that they have to approach the bench and bring this up outside the presence of the jury?
I'm getting ready to ask you, Mr. Ray, or Mr. Jeffries. To what extent could these six requests by Mr. Spencer be
certainly, if it said attorney-client privileged information, we could agree to that. That's privileged information. And that's why, and we are willing to entertain, that's why we have asked them again and again, tell us the categories. If there's like a list of parishioners or I would have to dream up what it might be, we might agree to that. But motions in limine, Your Honor, are normally very specific. It's, Your Honor, don't let them bring up that my client had a DWI in 1993 without first approaching the bench outside the presence of the jury. Here, they are literally saying that everything he knows from his 30 years in the Church of Scientology is confidential information, and we've got to stay away from it. And we have already instructed Mr. Rathbun not to disclose to us any attorney-client privileged information, and we would have no problem with that. And if they can show any other category of privileged information, trade secret, etc., then we would consider that, Your Honor. But he said, ridiculous or whatever, to suggest absurd that an order telling telling attorneys and non-party individuals that they cannot speak to each other, that that's just a normal motion in limine. That is not a normal motion in limine.
Well, like, but number two, could that not be a motion in limine? In other words, that's talking about wild testimony.
Yeah, that would be an emotion in limine. But, Your Honor, there's a case from Houston, 2012 case, Allison versus the Commission for Lawyer Discipline. And in there, the court says, absent a jury, a motion in limine is irrelevant. Therefore, a motion in limine is improper in a bench trial. We have coming up special appearance. We have this anti-slap motion that they gave you the big box on. And we have an injunctive hearing. None of those things involve a jury.
If I may, I hope we don't get off on the label in limine, because that really is not that important. The court knows the title of a motion is the body of the substance of it. And if you look at the introductory paragraph of the motion, it says that it is. Defendant Church of Scientology files this as motions in limine and for protective order as provided by Texas Rule of Civil Procedure 192.6b. And as Mr. Seal said, the reason we used in limine was because we were picking up on your order. But 192.6b gives very broad authority to a trial court. You've got a different version than I do, but it's 192, I was going to say what page it's on, but 192.6b to protect the movement from, and there are many things that can be protected, but here, undue burden, unnecessary expense, harassment, annoyance, or invasion of personal, constitutional, or property rights, the court may make any order in the interest of justice and may, among other things, and then they give a non-exhaustive list. That is the authority for the court to do what we're asking the court to do, if any even be needed, because I think those Supreme Court cases that we have repeatedly discussed make it clear that you have the power to do this, control the lawyers who are before you. And you will notice there is no, the request for relief is to the party, the plaintiff herself, and to the lawyers. Those are the ones we're asking you to instruct and to caution. So, of course, you have the authority. And whether it's called in limine or something else, it's really not an argument to have.
But, Your Honor, he correctly reads from Rule 192.6b that they actually have a burden. If they come to the court and seek a protective order, they have a burden to say, here is the matter, this would harm us. They have to show all of those things. Remember the In Re Mitla case, but they have taken the position They don't have to do any of that because they want to be governed by the rules where someone switches sides in midstream, as you said in your order. You rejected that properly. There is no case that would be analogous to ours that would put that burden on us. So if they don't have that, they cannot come down here and just say, Judge, presumptively, this is all confidential. We don't have to show harm. We don't have to show how it's a trade secret. We don't have to show anything. We pointed out in our motion, in our response to their motion, that the, and this is very much bears on this, quote, motion in limine. Texas Rule of Evidence 501 provides that no person has a privilege to prevent another from being a witness or disclosing any matter or producing any object or writing, except if there's a constitutional provision or the privileges that are recognized in the rule. So you notice they don't ever allege any of these things. Is there something that's lawyer-client privilege? As I said, we would agree not to seek lawyer-client privilege materials, and we would instruct Mr. Rathbun, as we already have, not to give us any lawyer-client privilege materials. Husband-wife privilege, communications to clergy, political vote, trade secrets, identity of informer privilege, and physician-patient privilege. You don't get to just go to court and say, we want a protective order. Tell them not to talk to these people, and they never give you any basis. I feel sometimes like I'm in Alice in Wonderland. If we're not dealing with the presumptive changing of sides in midstream situation, it is their burden to show you how they are being harmed, what the stuff is that would harm them, etc. And we've been in hearings like that over customer lists and pricing and all that kind of thing. But they refuse to say what it is, how they'll be harmed, etc. And they do have that burden.
And some of these things do become just repetition, but it's already been said. We have made it clear that based on his own affidavit, Mr. Rathbun comes within the umbrella of universe of people that should not be revealing confidential information, and I'm never going to get there. And this case, so that's the first part. If we prove it out of his affidavit, that
he doesn't use the word director of legal affairs. What he says is, I directed legal affairs, so I shortened it and turned it into a noun. Apologies needed, I apologize. And this is the same type of case. Read that affidavit. The whole point of it is, and it goes on for page after page after page, is that he was directly involved in the way in which Mr. Miscavige and the church, and when I say the church, that's both RPC and our client, CSI, supposedly do bad things in litigation, how they hide the ball, how they lie. You know, in fact, Mr. Miscavige, Mr. Rathbun, his affidavit in paragraphs 9 and 12 of it talks about how he personally falsely swears and denied things falsely, false declarations. He's a person that we need to be careful about out of his own mouth. But the point is, it's the same thing that Mr. Jeffrey is accusing us of doing. This is changing sides, because this is just in the same way that it was the safety systems in the helicopter case, the same things are in controversy here. So again, we can talk all day. If I haven't made that case, I'm not going to make it.
The point is, a motion in limine, while we're not in front of the jury, really is whether irrelevant is the right term or not, I don't know, but it is pointless. But yet, if we're not in front of the jury, simple objection to the ruling thereupon dealing with the issue. But I think I understand the purpose of seeking, whether it's a golf motion or whatever else it might be. privileged or whether it's broader than that, confidential, or if it's in response, if it's a defensive use, I think it's... Because I don't think this person has, or an entity has the ability to come in effect, hypothetically, party's current. But to perpetuate a brawl in court without reprise from the other side, I just don't think you can do that. Whether it's jurisdictional limitations, back to you, down the road, on the merits of the cause of action. I just don't think you can do that.
Judge, I understand your concern.
My point is, I don't think they can just come offer it, come say, look, the jurisdiction's established, boom, because we garnered this through some competence. Now, I mean, in other words, they can come try to rebut the prima facie case of no jurisdiction by way of using the deposition that they use that established that. And if it's further rebutted with something else and they think they've maybe have some information, that's when we'll start having that real debate, I think, is whether something was privileged, or whether it's merely confidential information, whether they have the ability to use it in a defensive posture or not. Granting a motion to limine, I'll wait until we get to the point where we're in front of a jury.
Your Honor, it really is, doesn't make any difference. The purpose of the motion to limine is to get a protection in place before we throw the skunk in the jury box. It's a proactive and preventative measure up front.
Right now it's just a box, it doesn't have a jury in it. So.
The point is, it's a measure that you take before the harm is done. And if you want to think about a generic term instead of a specific motion limiting, we fall within the generic purpose. So I was very comfortable using that. I kind of know when motion limiting come up, when they don't. But I thought you were looking at it conceptually, and I think conceptually,
right,
you're correct.
I am.
Sure. We're not to go into privileged information.
Your Honor, the problem with that is that the Supreme Court has defined confidential information to include both privileged and unprivileged information. Unprivileged information was obtained through certain set of circumstances. Whether you're a lawyer, you're a paralegal, you're PR man, director of legal affairs, whatever you want to call it, there is unprivileged information that is clearly
categorized. We're dealing with somebody who's high level, part of an organization, but information that is does not go directly to the merits, the factual merits of a particular cause of action. And so that's the problem I'm having. That's the category or the extent to which you might have some other information going to this issue as a matter of law as opposed to a matter of fact. And although it is based on fact, it will be novo decision.
And I know we're not in a motion to limit.
As opposed to a sufficiency type review.
And I know we're not in a motion to limit, but under the concept of a protection, what would be wrong with a system? If they come to you and they tell you, or they come to us and they tell us, we want to learn about the cafeteria practices, and why did you not have enchiladas on Wednesdays? Because that caused me emotional distress, because I grew up with enchiladas every Wednesday. I think, Your Honor, we're going to be able to work out among us, but that isn't the kind of non-privileged, confidential information that we're going to need to fight about.
This is the problem. They want to gag us ahead of time, and then make us go to them and ask them. Now, guys, is it okay for us to ask this question?
Everyone wants that to me. Yeah.
Well, and that's the problem. Yes. By trying to fit a disciplinary rule that applies to lawyers to a non-lawyer, that's the problem. It's with their definition, Your Honor. And they're asking you to extend a disciplinary rule to a non-lawyer.
Every protective order is a prior restraint. Every protective order is a gag order. Every protective order, for very, very good reasons, they operate as a way of gatekeeping. We are not extending a disciplinary rule. The disciplinary rule definition of standards as applied to a paralegal or to a director of legal affairs that is a non-lawyer would still be applicable. It just happens to coincide with what it says in the disciplinary rule. That doesn't mean we're extending it, Your Honor. I'm sure the court understands that distinction. And there's nothing inherently evil or wrong with a protective order functioning to protect. The way a limiting protects, the way a protective order protects, it's come check with me first. If it's non-privileged information that deals with the cafeteria, I promise you will never grace your presence with that question.
Your Honor, we will not. I think whatever order this court enters, we take obviously extremely seriously that we comply with. We will have no way to know whether we're in violation of an order or not if this definition is imposed. There's simply the way it is worded in the disciplinary rules to cover anything a client tells his lawyer, which is not the case here. We will never be able to know what we can talk to him or can't talk to him about. They will effectively preclude us from effectively representing our client.
Your Honor, it's going to be a question. It's a simple question to ask. Is this information that you know because of the work you did for during the time that you were there?
And that's the problem.
That's exactly what the rule says you're supposed to do. I mean, he would have learned. But for your presence as head of...
Well, again, see, that gets me back to my hypothetical. Regardless of the lawyer, regardless of the legal team that the plaintiff might have, then spouses get to sit back there on the back row.
And not function as an expert witness and not function as a consultant because the Supreme Court has said that when you fit this part, you can function as a spouse the way any other spouse would be able to function. But you want to fit in as a spouse functioning as an expert witness, and that's not what the spousal...
And even assuming that somebody, totally hypothetical situation, came in and was attempting to, whatever issue it was, in effect, whatever you want to call it, create a misimpression, commit a fraud upon the court or whatever, that they couldn't come and say, hey, you need to know this.
Well, and Your Honor, if what they're saying is true, I see that the court...
Or you can rebut that with this information.
If that's misleading.
If
your hypothetical assumes that the claim they're making is the gospel truth, I can see where the court would have a real hard time with that. I would too. But if you look at it as this is something he says because of what he learned inside, and the only way to rebut it is for us to waive our privilege or waive the confidentiality. That's what the rule is saying. No, we're not going to take it in the first instance from him because we don't want to put you in the untenable position. And that's not to say that, you know, that they're not going to be able to prove their case. Every example they've given you, they can give me all the examples you want. They say, you know, I know it's a lie because I went with him to fundraise in Texas, assuming that is relevant or determinative of the special appearance issue, okay? That's not the only way they can prove that, Your Honor.
Your Honor,
they're prohibited from using that information?
If Your Honor...
Because that's an activity. I mean, that's a... It's not confidential because they came to be on the town square to do that.
Exactly.
But they can't use him as a witness.
They can't use them to establish it, Your Honor, if he's only in a position to do it because of the position that he had, especially when they can establish it elsewhere, because you give it a stamp of reliability that everything he says, because I was there, would require us to come forth and rebut it with exposing the confidentiality in another instance. That's why you can't be a little bit pregnant in terms of waiving the privilege. You assert it or you don't. You waive it or you don't. That's I'm not here arguing anything that is extreme or new or novel, Your Honor. That is the principles behind the rules.
It is new and novel, and the defensive use is the point that keeps switching this, Your Honor. Mr. Cedillo said it, and he reversed it. This is their special appearance. They filed affidavits for Mr. Miscavige and others. That's how this came up. We filed a response with an affidavit rebutting it, which is exactly what he said a half hour, an hour ago that we could do. That's how we got here. This is not affirmative use. We are rebutting the factual inaccuracies that were contained in their affidavits, and they're trying to stop us from doing that. And beyond that, they're trying to stop us from even asking anybody whether these statements are true or not.
Okay. And Your Honor, the rule, when it applies, take the situation right there. Does that mean, Your Honor, that I could go to the current employee working with the executive and file the affidavit saying, no. No, I'm not. I'm not going to Texas. Could they go to his general counsel and compel him and force him to give information that contradicted? I think the answer is no, and why not? Because there is a privilege there. But it doesn't matter. His distinction about offensive or defensive use, the rule, the question is, does the rule apply because the parties fit? And then it's offensive, defensive, it doesn't matter. If it applies, Your Honor, it would apply there. They're going to have to rebut that affidavit another way. They can get the pilot. They can get someone they met with. They can do their work. But they don't have to do it, and the rule says they can't do it.
Could the spouse, in a hypothetical situation, say, go talk to the guy that landed in the airline on the Hudson, say he was a pilot?
Scully,
go talk to Scully. That's who you need to talk to. His phone number is. Can they do that? Or is that a violation of the confidence? I don't know how far you take it. That's
the hypothetical got moving parts. Can Scully, the pilot that flew in there?
All the birds.
Judge, I think the way the rule operates, if it was something he learned because of his position, but you know, Judge, there's flight manifests, there's records that get done. I mean, there's other ways of doing their work without going to an area the Supreme Court says is out of bounds.
The question is, is it privilege? They don't get to control how we conduct our discovery or how we want to interview this. This is what's crazy and novel about this whole concept that they're arguing. Trying to impose a definition that applies only to attorneys and information they gain from their clients onto a non-attorney, Your Honor, and then tell us that we would have no way of even knowing these other issues because I might risk being in violation of your order if it adopts this definition. I won't be able to even ask the question the way this is worded right now, Your Honor.
Judge, I mean, the Alice in Wonderland is to say we're only going to look at something that everyone will agree is privileged and will stay away from that. The privilege is the easy part, Judge. The unprivileged confidential information, that's the hard part.
And that's the subject.
That's what they want to do. They want it only limited to the privilege. And the Supreme Court said confidential orders or enforcement of confidentiality, it isn't limited to just the generally accepted privileges. It's unprivileged information as well. And again, it's not the disciplinary rule, it's the Supreme Court's definition in their holdings. The fact that it coincides with that definition is coincidental. We're not extending anything. Judge, I mean, I've had confidential information restrictions and protective orders that meet exactly verbatim what you have in the rules of professional conduct, and I've had them applied to engineers that left ACI in San Antonio, the medical device people. I've had them applied to any number of non-lawyers who had confidential information that is not privileged. Every trade secret case has that. The words are the same. So what? The concept of work that is being imposed is because they fit into an area that protections are required. And yeah, the definition.
But, and I understand the trade secret aspect of it, but whether or not there was a plane ride and who was on the plane.
If it was learned by somebody who was directing legal affairs, Your Honor, I think it would apply to the engineer if the engineer was running that. The trade secrets the analogy goes only so far because they're not, they have their scope of work, they have their involvement, and it's very easy to determine, is this what you did or didn't do?
Well, and that's why I was trying to come up with a way to limit it, because I just think, as written right here, under the circumstances that I'm dealing with,
Your Honor,
this much problem right now, I'm just with understanding, I was trying to read it a little bit differently and add to it.
He says that he oversaw and directed the defendant's legal affairs. He said that under oath.
To the extent that we're getting into privileged information, I think that's understood. I think they've instructed me. I've heard them.
But it's broader than that, Your Honor. That's why the attorney-client privilege doesn't stop and end, begin and end on the communication.
Riding on a plane for a fundraiser is not really a legal affair.
Well, Your Honor,
I've got that title over my name, assuming he was legal director.
I understand. I accept the court's distinction. It's not. It's the attorney-client or any privilege. The state attorney-client, the protection that's afforded doesn't end with just attorney-client communication. Work problem, strategy, the processes of thought that the attorney undertook that do not fall into the technical definition of a privileged communication.
No, but that's work problem.
Oh, but again, Judge, it is something that isn't technically the attorney-client communication privilege, and you still afforded protection. The analogy I'm making is that there are things that he learned because
that's
he
a
was
category
there.
Of a well-recognized privilege.
And even work product, Mr. Steele knows this and had this in the other case. Even that's not absolute. Attorney-client communications are just about absolute you get. Work product is not. This argument now that's coming up with work product is a complete red herring. We're in discovery phase. If they have evidentiary issues, they're free to raise those objections. TI hearing or special appearance hearing. But the issue right now is they're trying to stop us in our investigation to rebut claims they've made.
We're attempting, Your Honor, to have them respect the Supreme Court's mandates on what is protected information. And again, your approach to try to get to a lesser measure, called it a motion limiting concept. I guarantee you that if you want to devise something along those lines, I don't know what Mr. Rathbun is going to say. I was there and X. Okay, well, I was there and X and dealing with the cafeteria. We're not going to bring it to you. I was there and X deals with something that he only learned because he directed and oversaw the legal affairs. That's something that then we can bring to you. And that's a lesser measure, which is what you're trying to come to.
Your Honor, Mr. Spencer read to you Rule 1.05. I don't know if you've looked at that. That's what they're asking you to sign an order on. 1.05 says any information about the client in the course of representation. So they're applying that to Mr. Rathbun.
That's part of the problem, is in the course of representation, yeah, as opposed to in the course of employment.
Right.
Those are two distinct different things.
And he's not a lawyer, didn't represent him.
I've been wrestling with that.
So as it is written now, literally, we could not talk to Marty Rathbun about anything that happened in 30 years at the Church of Scientology. And by the way, we're back here again. They're arguing compellingly that there's this confidential information. They have yet to identify one piece of confidential information.
And I understand they claim they don't have to do it, and somebody's going to create more papers later on. But having this debate, I understand the framework of the debate. I was trying to come up with a good way to do it. One way I know how to do it, make it as clear as possible. Change it to be privileged information, striking the definition under 105, and then leaving the rest blank. But I mean, number two, I see that as being while he's testifying in front of me or a jury, I'm okay with that.
Well, except he uses the same definition. We can agree to, Your Honor, if we say privileged information. They had to be confidential in quotes there to come back to their definition under 105A. If we take anywhere they have quoted confidential information, if we substitute privileged attorney-client privileged information in there for 1, 2, 3, and 5, we've already told them we could live with that.
Well, I'm not looking at only being an attorney-client privilege. I mean, it could be work product. It could be tracing. It could be other categories. So, I mean, but maybe
at least that gives us some guidance, Your Honor.
Privileged in more general terms, but 1, 2, and 3 is privileged information. When it says confidential, that makes it a lot simpler for me. And then number 4.
Seal the courtroom. He's talking about sealing the courtroom.
No.
you can attach it under seal. The general rule, Your Honor, that you have the right to run your courtroom, how do you think you need to? That gives you the authority to do that.
Not according to Rule 76A.
I think he's talking about papers in the file.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, it's not in the file. He's going to be filing something new, Your Honor.
But it's already there.
Here's what the rule says. I'm sorry.
If it's already there, I understand what the rule says.
Right.
I'm suggesting that the court has a plenary power to say, when you file a new thing and you want to add something that I've told you not to further disseminate, even if it's a copy of what you've already done, file it under seal.
Or just got refer the
power,
to it by reference.
Or refer to it by reference. You've got the power to do that. You have the power to do that without publishing the newspaper that you're going to shut things down.
I'm not an appellate specialist here. I read the rule on special hearing responses and any affidavits or things we've got to attach. It's got to be 7 days before the hearing. So if it were just me and the abundance of caution, when I filed that amended response, I would attach that affidavit again just because I don't know what the Court of Appeals is going to say. So that's my concern.
But if you feel like you need to attach it, I don't have any opposition. It's a habit. Hollow ceiling since it's already in there, but the purpose of preserving the record for any appellate review, if you want to attach it in an envelope, label exhibit A or whatever, I don't have a problem with that.
Well, it is done and it is attached and it is in the record.
What normally happens, that affidavit is several pages long. I think they're only complaining about a paragraph. You don't get to seal an entire affidavit just because you're object to one or two paragraphs. They ask to redact or to seal those particular portions. I don't think it's proper to just say the whole affidavit is now sealed forevermore.
Okay. Well, the whole issue about sealing, I volunteer. Forget I ever mentioned. Just don't disseminate it any further beyond the court file.
We have the power to do that. Judge, just to be clear,
as well as any state statute rule or other common law,
state common law. Okay.
Privilege in regards. Anything else today?
Well, we do have the matter of the protective order and view of your ruling. That's the big protective order that sets up the framework. In view of your ruling, we did submit to you a proposed order that excludes the spouse or includes the spouse as for the
purposes of these jurisdictional issues, which is really the threshold, or that's as far as we've got right now. I'm okay with adding the spouse, but just for everybody's understanding, and once we get beyond that, I'm probably going to go right back to standard language from the Fifth Circuit.
And do you have a copy of the order up there with the spouse, or do you want us to give you another copy? We have it right here.
We just need something signed because they're not giving us any discovery until we get it signed. Okay. Well, I don't know. It may be up here somewhere.
Yes.
I got another copy.
But we didn't put it. And I'm happy to substitute the signature.
Your Honor, Mr. Jeffrey is representing, and we're accepting his representation that the sole and exclusive change he's made in this order to the one we prepared is that he added the words and the party's spouse on page 2, section D, double small I.
That's correct, Your Honor, and also. To take care of your issue about the signature line, although they're not signing off on it, we'll stipulate that they're not waiving their special appearance by. They're not signing off on the
motion. Or the motion. I mean, the one in the order, right? Are they signing off on yours?
I don't think they have to.
Yeah, they don't.
That's the
self-conscious sign.
Yours is the only important signature. And we can get a copy of that from Savannah.
That was the clerk's office.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.